差不多夠鐘啦,
It's almost time. We will move on to session 2 of the public hearing on children's expectation on the government. We'd like to welcome all to the meeting. May I remind you again, your speech is not covered by the Legislative Council and Powers and Privileges Ordinance. In other words, we have to take responsibility for your own speech, and each of you will have 3 minutes to speak. I will first invite you to speak, and then I will invite the administration to respond. After that, I will open the floor to other members. In the last session, one of the individuals was absent. She's only here, so I'll give her 3 minutes. Liberal Party. Sorry, there's some misunderstanding. That's why I'm only here now. I just want to share with you some anecdotes. This is my own experience and that of mothers and children in our group. Now these are the smaller details, that is when children are born and then they grow up, we find that there is not enough government support. First, when children are born, breastfeeding. We don't believe there is any systematic support. I did breastfeeding, but for groups that I know of, now, doctors or even within the public hospital system, different hospitals may have different support for breastfeeding, and different groups will have their own policies too. So as a new mother, or for children actually, it's not easy for them to adapt. Let's say this time the nurse will teach me to do this, and next time another nurse will teach me something else, so there is not uniform approach. That's on healthcare. Second point. In public hospitals, beds for infants or emergency beds are in a shortage. Now, I've been to public hospital, and yes, they would give priority to infants, but for the doctor's consultation. But after that, we have to wait for the next step of treatment, then it would take a long time. Now, I've bought health insurance for my daughter, but because there is a serious shortfall of hospital beds in the public sector, so even in the private hospitals, there is a serious shortfall of beds for infants. So I won't get a bed in a public hospital, I won't get it in a private hospital, and I feel helpless. Now, I have insurance policy, but still, I can't get a bed in a private hospital for my child. And then in public hospitals, usually children will be in big general ward, and there's no isolation. But then maybe there are children with foot and mouth disease, which is highly contagious, and that child could be right next to my child, and that affects the children. Now, a reason that I'm in hospital because I'm ill, but then next door their child has an even more contagious disease. And then that causes worry. Okay, next, Ms. Chung Ho Yi. I would like to play a recording. I'm Lam Ching Yi. I'm 7 years old. I'm a primary 2 student. My last school was really bad. They didn't treat us well. When we, if we made any mistake, they didn't give us a second chance. 3 teachers were unkind to students with special education needs, or like locking them up in a closet, and then the teacher would continue to teach with, and or some teachers would press the child onto the ground. So either you lie on the ground, I will ignore you, or you don't lie on the ground, then I will I'll sit on you. And the students were really scared when they saw that. They wanted to cry, they didn't want to go to school. We told the police, but the teachers and the principal didn't believe us. They wouldn't own up to the mistake. They didn't apologize. We have a whole class of good students. We did try to protect them. We did try to tell the police, and we told our parents we wanted people to believe in what we young children said. Now, young children only speak the truth. They won't lie. I hope my children would be courageous and honest. Now, my two children, they were in Yulong School. They were brave. They stood up for their classmates. They spoke up for them. And they were even prepared to give evidence in the police station, but then they suffered badly. Even now, they have moved to another school. They couldn't let go, and there was no psychologist to help them. And after the case was reported to police, the school kept asking them to come back to school as soon as possible. And when the police went to the school to take evidence, the school actually told other parents it was a misunderstanding. They said that the school was already trying very hard to support the students. And then what's worse is that the school told some parents that it never happened. It was something to do with the students. The students were being subjective. They thought it was real, it's just their imagination. They tried to negate all that the children said. Eventually, the case was not established as a child abuse case, so the school could actually tell people it never happened. Now, there were five students who witnessed it. Five students telling lies together. They all saw it wrong together. Is that possible? And then I went back to school one day, and there was a senior class student told my child, "So you are the girls who wouldn't come to class. Can we come back to class now?" We have asked for the Education Bureau to arrange a meeting on many occasions with the school so we could clarify the case so our children could speak the truth. But after months of effort, we got nowhere. Then my child woke up after a nightmare, and he said, "I never tell a lie, so do you believe me?" He said, "I feel really sad. Now, my child has special education needs. I can see children like this needs more accommodation and love." And then my child stood up for his friend, but then all he got was tears and a broken heart. So I hope there is a group that would be set up to look at things from children's perspective, and then it will speak up for children. Thank you.
Jermansin.
We'll continue to follow up on your case. Next, Ms. Jermansin. Good afternoon. I'd like to talk about the right of SEN students in receiving education. I have a 14-year-old child who has special educational needs. He changed three schools before. Because of the lower Chinese proficiency, his learning progress is also affected. And whereas English proficiency is higher, and therefore he has lost interest in class. Every night there are so many homework assignments, and he stays up until 11:30. We've talked to the school before, and our relationship is tense. But one day, he told me this. What is the purpose of life? Is it just about finishing homework? And eventually I decided to change the school because he has normal intellectual capability. He is turned down by an SEN school in the end. I applied for school that could cater for his needs, and he spent 3 years there, and he could read storybooks, and he had a very good he had a very happy time there. I tried to look for an international school place for him, and the answer I got was always no support, no resources, etc. Last year I started homeschooling. I joined a number of WhatsApp parents groups, and every day I receive 100 to 200 messages, and every week I also talk on the phone with other SEN parents. My son has normal capability, but then his capability is only assessed on the Chinese, English, and mathematics subjects. There are no suitable measures to help with their learning. And parents are very concerned because the schools always complain about the result and conduct of these students. And I recently discovered that some of the SEN students' parents are on the antidepressants. And she also told me that she'd like to commit suicide. In 2014, there were 10 sessions of public hearing on the review of integrated education, and the report submitted to the government was that there should be legislation in UK, US, these advanced economies, and even our neighboring place, Taiwan. They have set up, they have formulated this policy for SEN students for over 30 years. And yet the government's reply is, as usual, we have deployed a lot of resources, we have done our best, and that the resources are limited. And then what is most hard to pallet is the following, that we've tried our best and legislation may not be necessary. The parents are really furious. I want to know when the government will enact legislation for SEN students. In fact, last year, priority had been given to reviewing CAP 27 about the or Section 27 of the Disability Discrimination Ordinance about accommodation and facilities for SEN students, and that the proposal was withdrawn. Our parents are disappointed. Next. Ms. Lee, originally I wanted to bring my son along, but then because of a huge amount of schoolwork, he couldn't come, and this is the recording. Good afternoon, I'm Chu Manchun. I am 13 and a half years old. I am in secondary form 2. I want to say, talk about the school that I'd like to go to. First, I want to get up at 8 o'clock. The school hour should not begin too early, and that I can go to school at 9 a.m. instead. And then during the morning session, there would be mainly theories. Then in the afternoon, we can have discussion sessions. We can have field trips for geography lessons, and we can also go outdoors to exercise. And point number 3, there should be different subjects available in schools so that students can choose the subjects according to their interests. There should be IT, there should be music, physical education, home science, language, physics, history, etc. There should be also be a subject for self-care, so that students can learn about self-care skills. Now, point number 4, for children below the age of 16, there should not be any exams, tests. There should only be limited scope of assessment for certain subjects. There should be different reward schemes, conscientious award, participation award, so as to encourage students to learn. There should be 2 refreshment kiosks in schools. There should be a wide variety of refreshments available so that, and also there should be a large school campus with a happy learning environment. Students should be able to go off school on time. There should not be a need for students to attend tutorial classes so that students can be interested in going to school. And the board games, reading, browsing the internet should be allowed in school, and there should also be time for children to communicate with their parents. I would appeal to the government to reform the boring education system so that we can have more diversity. Thank you. I hope that when my son wakes up, he will not say that he doesn't want to go to school, and that there should be diversity in schools. All right, we'll keep this audio recording and pass it to Mr. Eddie Ng. He doesn't need to read a book a day. He can just listen to your son. Next, Ms. Ho Mei Yi, spokesperson for the Parents Alliance. Good afternoon. This is the third occasion I attend the electricals meeting to speak the mind of many parents. Every time I get emotional, and this time I've heard the speeches made by parents about what happened to their children in school, and I can't help but think that we need a mechanism in Hong Kong to give children their right to play, to learn, to rest, and to eat well. And yet, as far as Hong Kong's education system is concerned, it seems that the children enjoy none of these rights. We are party to the convention, but then we have not implemented anything to allow our children to enjoy these rights. How can we set up this mechanism? Just now, Dr. Fernando Zhang said that a commission should be set up to discuss this issue, but I think that it's more than just a commission. We need legislation. We need child health policy to look after the physical and mental well-being of children so that we can really cater for the needs of different children. I have three children, and in terms of their physical well-being in the course of their development, there is nothing. Because of the heavy schoolwork, they spend much time in revision and completing homework, and they are not allowed to run during recess and in school, and they are trapped in school like a log, and they feel like exploding. So how about allowing them to play in playgrounds and sports grounds? The playgrounds in Hong Kong are overly protective. Even an 8-year-old will dislike going to such a playground, and yet it's suggested that the playground is suitable for children between 5 and 12, but a 12-year-old would find such a playground infantile. So I don't think the society can cater for their needs. Apart from physical well-being, I can describe that these students nowadays are very depressed. All they think about is how they could avoid being scolded by teachers, how they can complete all the assignments, and they want to avoid school. Well, learning languages is difficult. We have mostly Chinese, English, and mathematics. I don't know what the language curriculum is about, but I am really disheartened because we are Chinese, but we totally lose interest in the Chinese language subject. I think the Education Bureau should consider comprehensively the curriculum. The TSA is still going on. I have talked about it so many times. In 2017, well, Mr. Ng, the Secretary for Education, said that the TSA should be undertaken, despite there is so much opposition in society. So we want to join hands in appealing to the government at this point. Next, Ms. Zhang Tianwen from Pathfinders. I'm the legal case manager of Pathfinders. We are a Hong Kong registered charity organization in Hong Kong. We want to ensure that the most vulnerable children born in Hong Kong and their migrant mothers are respected and protected. From inception in 2007 to date, we have helped over 4,300 children and their migrant mothers. These mothers are mostly migrant domestic workers. And in 2016, 86% of the baby's biological fathers lived in Hong Kong. So this is a local issue. And undoubtedly, these foreign domestic workers have contributed a lot to our society. But whilst they take care of our children, their children are not protected because of lack of a clear policy on this matter. And these children are neglected even before they are born. So I'm speaking out on behalf of these babies still to be born. They should be protected, and yet at present, we have laws to protect these foreign domestic workers from being terminated because of pregnancy, and yet there is no policy or guidelines to cater for the needs of the babies of these foreign domestic workers. And there is also a living requirement. And because of that, we do not have guidelines to make sure that these mothers can enjoy happy, healthy pregnancy. And this would seriously affect the babies to be born. And they are the forgotten group. They are the ghost children that are by and large neglected by society. They do not have the resources needed. The Pathfinders have helped over 1,400 such babies so far. And this is not a one-off incident. The government should attach importance to this matter. They should be given level playing field. I have five suggestions. First, in terms of the statutory maternity leave, there should be a review on the living requirement for foreign domestic workers. And there should also be clear explanation on how foreign domestic workers' pregnancies can be protected so that they can enjoy happy, healthy pregnancy, and different parties should understand their responsibilities. Point number three, there should be a review on the babies delivered in the mainland, and also point number four, regardless of the status of the foreign domestic workers, the babies should enjoy vaccination. And point number five, the fees, ID document fees should be exempted. And there should also be an exemption of the requirement for the submission of the documents before the mothers are allowed to be discharged.
From DB, Ms. Lai Kamen. Thank you. Children are the future of Hong Kong. They are important for our social development. The DAB has always been concerned about children's rights, and the government is duty-bound to provide support to children. We have a children's committee and women's committee, and the committees have done many surveys and research. Now, there have been a number of cases of student suicide in March last year. The DAB conducted a survey. 84% of the parents felt that their children were under pressure because of studies. And children would throw tantrums, they might cry, they might become very quiet, or they might not be able to sleep. So the government should set up a dedicated committee as soon as possible to look into the causes of these suicide cases so they could come up with measures to deal with them. And then at the school level and community level, the government should provide more resources to give more support to students who are suicidal. This will allow for timely intervention and counseling. There must also be more school-based social workers. And there should be strengthened support by providing psychological services. And then there could also be a hotline, so through a phone call we can reach out to high-risk young people and students. Now, of course, there must be healthy families too. So the government should set up the family council as soon as possible so you could promote such family-friendly practices and policies. And there could be more talks for parents on parenting, that so parents know how to communicate with children and there won't be a generation gap. And then for grassroots children, they have a serious problem trying to meet the heavy school expenses at the start of school year. Now, 65% of the parents interviewed believe that textbook prices continue to go up, and 35% of the kindergarten parents have to spend $500 to $1,000 on textbooks, and 30% of parents have to spend $500 to $1,000 to buy school uniforms and other accessories. So the costs are spiraling for going to school, and that's why the book textbook subsidy should be extended to kindergarten students. It's to make sure that there must also be subsidy for low-income students to take part in extracurricular activities. With changing times, children now face various complicated issues, so we need to put our heads together to find solutions. And that's why we think the government should set up a children's council, so that the government could fulfill its obligations under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. So when with this platform, we're able to hear the views of children and understand their needs. And through this council, we could also assess the effectiveness of current policies. Thank you.
Christian Arjun Hotwani.
Good evening. My name is Christian Hotwani from the Zubin Foundation. We are a local registered charity focusing on social issues that do not get enough attention in Hong Kong, particularly relating to ethnic minorities. We are currently conducting a landscape study on primary education for non-Chinese speaking children with special educational needs in Hong Kong, and our findings will be released in October. In February, Policy 21 released their study on the provision of international school places in Hong Kong, commissioned by the EDB. Three of their five recommendations related to special educational needs and called for further research in this area. We hope that when published, our research will help to fill the current void of information. We wanted to share some of our initial findings from parents and schools so far that affect a child's right to appropriate education. One, parents have consistently commented that they have difficulty in finding appropriate education for their children with special educational needs. Two, there are no English-speaking public special schools or English-speaking classes within Chinese-speaking public special schools. Three, there are not enough private school places for children with special educational needs. Four, finding information about schools is very difficult. Many schools offering alternative curriculums do not appear on lists of private schools, and therefore parents only hear about these schools from other parents. Five, early identification and intervention is essential. However, not all kindergarten and primary teachers have had sufficient training to distinguish between children who may have special educational needs compared to children who are struggling to learn due to language or cultural differences. Six, when children are assessed for possible special educational needs through government services, they have their assessments in Chinese or English. However, for a number of children, neither of these languages is their first language. Their results end up being based on performance in assessments carried out in either their second, third, or even fourth language. We would like to see the government provide, one, clearer information about all schools in Hong Kong and more detailed information about support services provided in each school. Two, greater training provided to kindergarten and primary school teachers to help them in identifying, understanding, and supporting children from different language and cultural backgrounds. This should be part of the initial teacher training as well as part of the continuing professional development for all teachers. Three, assessment services that cater to the needs of these children, whether through the use of alternative language assessments or through extra consideration of the child's impact, the impact of the child's background of the assessment results. These are just some of the many issues that have already become clear from our research. We look forward to being able to continue to contribute to further discussions on these issues, and we'll cover them all in full detail in our final report. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. 跟着我们来讲.
Next, from New Democrats, Mr. Fong Kwanon. Thank you. Same as before, I'm here today facing, I don't know, these officers or secretaries. I don't know how focused you are in following our discussion. I hope you're not just here in person. Maybe even after you've heard the views today, you won't go back and tell Edium. I hope that's not the case. Anyway, you are subordinates yourselves. You've commissioned a professor to do a report on preventing student suicide. Did you read the report? Did they not answer? I'm here. Did you read the report? After you've read the report, what have you got from it? What have you got from the report? What are you going to follow up on? Because there are many more lives lost. How many more lives are you going to lose? There's no need to do further research. We're talking about people taking their own lives right in front of you. But of course, you are just subordinates. You would just take orders from the person in charge, high above, right? Fine. Even that's fine. Now, there are a lot of complaints about the education system. This is what I've got. But then the more urgent issue is TSA. Some parents just mentioned it, but you still insist of going ahead with it. The DAB and other pro-establishment camp initially supported TSA, but now I think at district council level, most are against it. The free C candidates are against it too. So what are you doing here? If that's not enough, okay, I'll show you this as well. When we do street stations, these are the signatures we collected from parents. It's only just from Chiang Kwan Oh, 1,500 signatures already. So what do you want? What more evidence do you need? And many of those who came up to sign the names were primary school students in uniforms. Can you not hear what they're trying to say? You think it's tough for sitting here all afternoon? I can tell you students suffer a lot more every day in school. If you think that, you know, it's a waste of time sitting here listening to us, yes, you can just leave. Now, the first time when we talk about student suicide, when there was the first case, Edim said he had other engagement, he just left. So what are these lives to you, really? Okay, a report was completed. You use other examples of overseas, and you say that in Hong Kong there are relatively fewer cases. But we don't want to lose even one life. It's not a competition. And for the whole education system, there is need for reform. But first and foremost, TSA must be abolished. Please, can I spend another 10 seconds or so to hand over the signatures to them? Because this represents the views of over 1,000 residents, I hope they will accept it. You can give it to our security staff. Thank you very much. Mr. Fong, next, Hong Kong Society for Asylum Seekers and Refugees, Ms. Choi Fung Yi. Good afternoon. There are some 600 refugee children. They're second generation. Most of them were born in Hong Kong, but like their parents, they don't have right of abode in Hong Kong. On the birth certificate status, in the status columns that are uncertain, so they could be locked up and repatriated any time. A member came to see our person in charge, Isabella. They said that the officer was nice, he would create a new case for him. So Isabella found it strange, so she went with him to go and sign. And then Isabella found that the case officer was just trying to warn him that next week, if he came back, if he didn't have any outstanding case, that would be the last day he'd spend in Hong Kong, and he and his 5-year-old child will be repatriated at once. So the case officer and the non-reformant claimant, between them, there's a serious miscommunication. No one knows about the communication process, because for these claimants, they don't speak much English, probably, and perhaps the case officer does not explain the case clearly. But anyway, the horrible truth is that if no one interfered, then the claimant would have thought that the case officer is trying to help him. And then the minute he's repatriated, he still wouldn't know that's the case. And then here we're talking about a child just a few years old. Of course, the child wouldn't know what's going on. Maybe the child is still in class, and all of a sudden he'll be repatriated. So for a few-year-old child, he might be scared. The child might ask, how come, what have I done wrong? How come I'm locked up? How come I can't go to school? And all of a sudden, the child will be sent to a totally strange place without friends. And then the child would feel insecure. And then the school would know nothing about it either. So the coordination has been really poor. And that's why I think the government should make better arrangement. When a case is completed, they must inform the claimant clearly so they know exactly what's going on. And there's no need to repatriate the claimants at once. At least allow the children to finish the semester. And then the case should be handled more the cases should be handled more properly, and they should inform schools. We're going to show a short video. There's a boy, Ali. He likes soccer. He plays well. Then the school sent the team on training, but he's got no identity, so he couldn't take part in the training trip. And then he asked Isabella how come he couldn't do it. He asked whether they could arrange a passport for him, but Isabella was so sad that because she didn't know how to explain to Ali what an identity meant and how come Ali had no identity, because that would be too cruel a fact for him. He thought he was protected, but that couldn't be further removed from the truth. So these children would feel insecure and they would lose hope in the future because they don't have an identity and they couldn't do anything in future.
Thank you. Next, Ms. Yong Zi-Wai. Thank you, Chairman. Many refugee children, like the previous deputation said, face a lot of difficulties. Well, at least their rights to education should not be deprived of. As refugee children, it's difficult for them to find a school place, and we have social work, we have volunteers to help them ring up schools, and yet many of them are on the reconnaissance paper, and schools find it difficult to accept, to admit them. And we think that the government can formulate a set of guidelines to help them get a school place so as not to take away these children's rights to education. Many refugee children can speak many languages. One of our members' daughter, Jennifer, speak 4 or 5 languages. At the age of 4 or 5, she can speak Hindu, Urdu, English, etc. And yet when it comes to doing homework, it's either Cantonese or Chinese. And when she returns home, her family speaks Urdu or Indonesian, and her mother would need to find help elsewhere. And I also came across a case, an African mother with her limited English asked me what about her daughter's homework, and Alfaso's mother, another member, also tried the same, but when she approached someone for help, not everyone would be as friendly, and not everyone would be as patient as to answer all the questions in the homework sheet. So I think we should ask some NGOs to arrange for classes for these children to be integrated in society. According to the UNCRC, children should be able to enjoy leisure and should be able, should have the right to take part in cultural and recreational activities. And yet subsidies given to these families are limited. There may not be resources to allow children to take part in extracurricular activities, let alone school trips. So in the remission scheme, I think that it can be strengthened so that school children can, these children can be integrated in the school and for them to take part in the school activities. In the long term, we should give hope to these refugee children, so that they have interest in learning, and there should be a talent scheme to subsidize these children for university admission so that they can get rid of their identity as a refugee and contribute to our society. Next, Kamaji Kaur. Good afternoon, Chairman, members. The first point I'd like to make is teaching Putonghua in school. Even for Chinese-speaking students, it's already a tricky issue. For non-Chinese-speaking students, it's even more difficult. Their family members may not even speak Cantonese, and they can only learn Chinese in school. And if the Chinese language subject is taught in Putonghua, it's even more confusing for them. They don't know what is going on. And they may get even more confused whether they're learning Cantonese or Putonghua. I'm not against learning Putonghua, but I hope that a separate class can be arranged instead of learning Chinese in Putonghua, because it's confusing for the students. And I don't understand why the Education Bureau is advocating this practice, because when it, although you suggest that it's up to the school's management on this matter, it is still, after all, your policy, and there should be some form of regulation. Some school children at the time of admission may not know that Chinese will be taught in Putonghua. And even for kindergarten students, they may be able to get into a good kindergarten, but when the medium is switched from Cantonese to Putonghua, then they may fail easily. It's not because the children do not want to learn. It's because of this overhaul that prevents them from learning. We are party to this convention, but it seems that the government is taking the initiative to take away the students' interest in learning Chinese. I hope that the Education Bureau can consider scrapping this arrangement, because it has been in place for some time, and we understand that it is not yielding results. The other point is about kindergarten. Well, we've often been told that if we want to learn Chinese well, we need to start at kindergarten. But have you considered that we are being turned down by many kindergartens? I have many friends approaching local kindergartens, but have been told that they would only take locals. And you, as an expatriate, should go next door to the international kindergarten. But then my friend would say that I'm a taxpayer, my daughter is born in Hong Kong, why can't I be admitted? And yet, she was turned down without explanation. When she tried to ask for more information, the other party would ask her to go online for information. She would even be turned down for a face-to-face interview, for a meeting. And this doesn't just happen to a single kindergarten, but every kindergarten in every district. Our children already need to study in another district. They already have a lot of homework to do. So please answer directly whether you're committed to resolve the problem. Don't just repeat your official line. We'll invite the government to respond in a moment. Next, Mr. Joey Yu. Chairman, good afternoon. I'm one of the volunteers for Hong Kong Society for Asylum Seekers and Refugees. At the time when this society was set up, very often I would go with the chair to visit the homes of asylum seekers or refugees, and I came across children from different nationalities, and these are refugee children. They live in undesirable living conditions. They don't even have the basic necessities. According to the UN Convention on the Rights of Children, the parents should be given support in terms of policy and resources for the children to exercise their rights, in particular in terms of nutrition and accommodation. But is there anything like that in Hong Kong? We allow food coupons to children amounting to $1,200 a month, but the food coupons cannot meet all the nutrition needs of children because these parents are usually jobless. They do not have cash. So let's imagine, for local children, how many new set of clothes they have in a year. In every season, they get four or five sets of new clothing, whereas for the refugee children, they would be very happy just to get one new set. As for asylum seekers and refugee children in Hong Kong, they also have the right to receive education. We also have a remission scheme to help their parents, to help them meet the school fees and other meal expenses. And yet, school uniform, textbook expenses, and travel expenses are not covered. So these school children do not have the necessary resources to go to school. So how can they enjoy school life? And now we have different measures, such as second-hand school uniform, but it's not available in all schools. We have such 600 refugee house families in Hong Kong, and I think the NGOs can do more to help. For example, subsidies can be provided for school children to meet their textbooks and traveling expenses. And another volunteer just now also mentioned this point. Children should have the right to enjoy leisure time, and also they should be able to take part in after-school activities. But for refugee children, they do not have the resources. They cannot afford after-school activities. For example, when it comes to playing musical instrument, we have this member. The child would like to go on a school trip, but the family is unable to afford it. And as a result, the child has to wait in the teacher's room for other children to return from the trip. And the child is so unhappy because the child doesn't understand why he cannot enjoy this ride. We can partner with other NGOs like Hong Kong Jockey Club, because there is a scheme to subsidize school children to go on school trips, and the scheme should be extended to cover refugee children so that they can also enjoy their time in school. We have this video clip with refugee mothers telling you that request. Are you going to play the clip? Just now, a number of volunteers have talked about refugee children, and I'm going to play the clip on behalf of the society.
我叫阿Leo，今年14岁，因为我想踢足球，所以我打我打唔到波，因为我要password，所以我想咩就播。我而家都冇idea，如果冇idea嘅话，都整唔到password啦。我觉得好失望咯，我踢唔到波，又帮唔到佢哋，又唔可以合作，我翻学嘅时候好开心啦，我啲朋友成日同我好好啦，转嚟可以翻工嘅时候咪食嘢。 如果我有ID嘅話，我就可以生活好啲啦，又幸福啲，同媽咪一齊開開心心啦。我叫
Jennifer。<笑>你中唔中意翻學啊？中意，好多朋友同我玩、畫畫、做功課。我中意英文科同埋中文科。
我系香港人，我住喺香港5年，我中意住喺香港。我想做医生，有人发烧咳咳啦，帮佢啦。我希望佢做人身体好啲，跟住咧佢学系学校嗰啲好啲。政府叫我婚姻呢？ 系啊，但系如果可以，我唔要婚姻咧，我唔要爹哋同佢分手咁样嘛。系啊。My
name is Gustav.
Gustav, you want to go school?
Yeah.
And then you want to find friends?
Yeah.
And then you want to learn?
Yeah.
My name is Myla. I am a refugee. One of our difficulties here is to find a school for our kids. My kids already 3.5 years not yet go to school because they haven't accepted. They always reject her for the government. I want them to help us for the difficulties of the kids. At least our kids also is also born in Hong Kong, right? So at least they giving also for them the like Hong Kong residents. At least for the kids, take care of their problem.
And some school asking you money for the down payment, but we don't have money because we don't have work. I just only take care of my daughter. I want my daughter is she helping also the other babies, refugees. So I want my daughter is become teacher someday.
我叫 Fashion， 我今年5岁。
You like Hong Kong?
媽媽， Hong Kong
喺邊度啊？喺呢度咯，呢度係香港。開心。好。Thank you. It's really an impressive clip. Next, Ms. Chen Ka-Pui from Southern District Council. Thank you, Chairman. I'm Chen Ka-Pui, Southern District Councillor from New People's Party. About the new arrivals, we have a lot of problems, and Mrs. Regina Yip in her election platform also suggested setting up a children's commission, and I support that. The last administration attached importance to helping the elderly and and poverty alleviation. I think we're neglecting the needs of our next generation. As far as existing policies are concerned, there aren't sufficient resources for our parents. For babies to the three-year-olds, we do not have targeted support for them. Mrs. Carrie Lam is the only female CE candidate, and I think there is something of this sort in her election platform. I hope that she will honor her election pledge and do something for our mothers. I'm a new mother, and I understand, I have this first-hand experience. I think that there is still much room to improve as far as government policies are concerned. Let me just cite one example. 3 months after my baby was born, there was one troubling issue. I need to pump breast milk during work, and yet at the district office there wasn't any, such a breastfeeding room, and the toilet wasn't clean, and the chairman of the DC lent me the room for pumping breast milk. But I think that the government should set up more such breastfeeding rooms for mothers in government buildings, and also there should be more. And recently, there was a piece of news about the airport authority offering a nursery room for staff members of the AA, and I think that a similar facility should be provided for other sectors, so that we can unleash women's potential in the workforce and also boost our birth rate. Thank you, Ms. Chen Ka-Pui.
Ms. Zhilai San from SOCO. Thank you. Last time, told you about the report on children's right, housing, healthcare, CSSA are the issues mentioned. Today, I'd like to talk about the situation of new arrival children. The Equal Opportunities Commission consulted on anti-discrimination legislation for several years. Last year, a report was published, and only now we hear that the Legislative Council and the government will follow up on the report, but still they're not going to follow up on the section regarding new arrivals. Now, in our survey in the past few years, some 70 to 80% of new arrivals suffered discrimination. That's been a rather steady, stable percentage. And some of them are children. They experience discrimination. They say when they go to school, people call them mainland girls. Even these days, they call names. And then if the children go to playgrounds or the park, and then people will call the children and their mothers locust. So when children come across such a situation, they don't know where they could turn to make a complaint because there's no legislation. Of course, they are not beaten up to the extent that they can call the police, and they're just insulted. And then some children refuse to go to school. Some of the mothers said because they experience so much discrimination, the children don't want to go to school. Or they become afraid when they are told they will go to the park. So both adults and children have to face this problem. We believe there is urgency for the government to legislate against such discrimination. In fact, the UN has asked the government to legislate against discrimination on the ground of place of birth. This was a recommendation some 10 years ago, but it's not implemented yet. Now, I want to talk about children of single parents. Now, these children suffer much misfortune. Either their father passed away soon after they were born, or the fathers just ran off. So the mother is here on a two-way permit. Sometimes it's 14 days, sometimes 3 months. And it's hard for them to get multiple visas, and some live on CSSA. So these children are actually orphans, more or less, in Hong Kong. Now, some have been waiting since birth, and now they are 10 years old, 8 years old, or even in their teens. And there's some long-term separation with their mother. It's really torture for children. So on the one-way permit, the government should have discretion to grant a one-way permit to these people. And the government should have a central database so they could try to collect information on different types of children, and then they could have a proper policy response. Annie Jung, thank you. I heard different views here today. Now, I'm from the Parents League as well. In the past few months, we went to different places and met many different people. We staged demonstration, protests. We met the CE candidates last week. We went to meet with Matthew Jerome this month. We went to see Region Yip, and we went to Eastern District Council, and we set up stations. But we're just ordinary parents. Why do we have to work so hard? Our only and straightforward demand is then to not do TSA this year. And then there are some research findings, and then when there are such findings, I have to spend a lot of time to study them, and then I have to do comparison, and I find that yes, it's true in other places they have a test similar to TSAs, but in most cases parents have a choice. And in some cases they only do the assessment every 3 years. I don't know what the Hong Kong government is doing here. We don't really care who will be the next chief executive. Because you, the civil servants, are the one leading the government in getting things done. We know it's nothing to do with the so-called chief executive. So you, the officials here, sitting here, please use your conscience and do something for our next generation. The education bureau is paying about $70,000 per student to the school, and school fees could range from $40,000 to $100,000. That's international schools, and that includes profit as well. How come international schools could achieve happy learning? How come local schools can't? My daughter has just switched to international school for about half a year. Now, she made some interesting comments. She said, I'm happy, very happy. Why? Because I'm able to learn what I want to learn. So listen to that carefully. She is able to learn what she wants to learn. It's not what we want her to learn. And that's the very source of motivation for learning. Now, we talk about basic competencies. We talk about internationally accredited exams. But we forget learning motivation is about what encourages brings the children to class. Now, my daughter was going to come, but she couldn't make it. So she's done a lot of research in her class. And so we can hear what children care about. And they care about something totally different than that for the other children in local schools. So are we all in Hong Kong? How come the difference could be so huge? $70,000 of tuition fees, how much actually goes to the $70,000 of subsidies from the Education Bureau, how much is actually spent on children? Can the Education Bureau answer me? I'm also a member of the Parents League. I'm here as a parent to say a few words. Children's rights. Children actually don't have much rights in Hong Kong. So I'm in support of a committee on children's rights, so more could be done for children. I followed the speeches made on the 20th of March, Monday. It seems that children face a serious problem, a lack of time. Now here, Hong Kong is supposed to be an advanced city. How come children don't have time? All children say, well, they have to do homework, they have to prepare for dictations, for tests. They have no time. And children need time. It's important. They need the time to play, to rest, to learn, or to spend time with friends. This is their real needs. And Lenny was just saying that, was just trying to tell us what children want. The education bill mentioned something like a start from your heart. Please retract that. I could throw up on hearing that. It's ridiculous. Where is your heart? Where do you put your heart? Today here we talk about children's rights, and the education bill should be an important stakeholder. Because for rural students in Hong Kong, they are in schools provided by you. So education is important. But you know, for the officials here, I don't think you are too senior, right? I remember Eddie once said, if there's a permanent secretary here, that's already a very high level. But I don't see any permanent secretaries here. So how much do you care about what students have, the children have to say? Yeah, I mean, don't say that you're starting from your heart. And I mean, it gives me goose. Pimples and how can you say that? Don't you feel shame saying that? Anyway, on the curriculum, can you trim any part of it? I know you're actively promoting STEAM, and I was just reading the overview. There's one point here, I'll read it out. Based on the current advantage, Hong Kong is going to promote STEAM, and is based on the experience and other advantages of schools. That is, schools could make flexible use of class hours, and they could arrange for all-round learning. Now, if you think that schools could flexibly arrange activities, you are totally out of touch. I don't even know where you are, because I've been in touch with many schools and heads and teachers. They're not able to make good use of the time. Even if they want to arrange activities for children, to you know, distress, because we have we're promoting something like that is to prevent student suicide. But schools tell us it's impossible for them to find time, and then you say you will strengthen such learning activities, whatever. But if you don't do less, how is there time for students? If you don't even understand that logic, I think the Education Bureau should just do nothing. Perhaps if you don't do anything, that's the best for students. Next, Wong Long Fen. I'm here at the Legislative Council to tell you that I want all Hong Kong children don't have to do TSA drilling exercises, and then they have a lot of time to play every day. They're able to chat with their friends and play games with their friends, because children do need to play. Schools should lessen the restrictions, because we're not able to move at all day in school. Maybe there are not enough computers in school. For students to do their homework, and then other students can't use the computer. So the computers have to be used for doing homework, and other students can't use the computers for playing games. So we need more computers. And there must be longer recess. And we need more freedom. For example, children should be allowed to play hide and seek, because they need to move about. And also, children are really smart. They won't hurt themselves so easily. Adults are overly concerned, and therefore they are imposing more and more rules. I'm a BMX athlete. I've been riding BMX for 3 years. At first, when I started doing BMX, the track was smooth and safe, but now there are many potholes. One time, I wasn't able to avoid a pothole, so I fell. I hope the Hong Kong government could help us to repair the track so children could continue to train there. We love to ride BMX because, you know, as we come rushing down or when we fly in the air, it's really exhilarating. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you. How old are you, Wong Lok Fan? I'm 9 years old. Okay, 9 years old. Thank you.
Next, Sin Wai Han. Chairman, good afternoon. Thank you, Fun Fun. I am a parent of a group of athletes undergoing formal BMX training, and I'm happy to be here to speak on behalf of these athletes. We originally had this very safe safe venue for training. It's in Kwai Chong. It's a Hong Kong Jockey Club's venue. However, because of the contractor's default on maintaining the venue, starting from 2009, the venue has become dilapidated, and all international competitions are no longer held here. And last year, because of a child got injured, the 350-meter track was closed, and that these athletes no longer had an official venue for training. And these BMX athletes would like to speak their minds so that the government can reopen this international track for BMX athletes. And it's said that on Monday, it is said that the government will follow up on the matter, and now we have heard nothing about it. And in fact, on the 13th of on the 11th of March, it was already said that the two tenders received were not up to their standard. And in fact, we met with two members. First of all, they do not have the money, and they did not commit it. And they only said that the tendering exercise would be initiated again, and there would be just another repeat. At the meeting, we said that as a short-term measure, parents as volunteers can help level the track. And in fact, we did the same in 2015 with good results. But the Hong Kong Cycling Association said that without insurance coverage, we would not be allowed to do it again. And we asked about the insurance coverage, what it was about, and if necessary, we can take out an insurance policy. But Martin Poon, attending the meeting, said that he still needed to ask, and it's been 2 years since 2015. Why wasn't there then an answer? And he just said that he needed to ask about it, and we haven't received any reply so far. And I'd like to tell everyone that as far as the education system is concerned, it's full of flaws. The next generation are now suicidal, and the athletes have been trained for 8 years. They like to represent Hong Kong in international competitions, and yet because of the irresponsible government, their dreams die. And I hope that the government can undertake this responsibility to repair all the facilities so that the international track can be open, and there should be more resources to train our BMX athletes, because for other athletes they can do some weight training with dumbbells, but for us we can only lift sandbags because we don't have the money. Thank you, Msin. Ms. Fong Siu Lai from Hong Kong Pediatric Fund. Oh, Ms. Zhao Wan Si. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to speak on the policy. As far as children's rights are concerned, it covers different aspects such as health, drug abuse, social relationship, etc. The UN Commission criticized Hong Kong government for not using resources to help children and young people by formulating policies to cater for their needs. And they face different challenges, including academic pressure. In 2015, Hong Kong had the lead in water incident, and we also have a number of recent cases of suicide by young people and primary students. The government has not come up with any concrete measures to follow up on the matter. According to the fund survey in 2016, we In terms of different health problems, 70% of young people would not go to a doctor. They would only rely on information sought online. And many young people believe that their first-hand experience of peers would be more reliable than doctors. The consequences are dire. If we have the children's policy, we can also help enhance knowledge among young people. So in the long term, we believe that the children's policy is necessary to resolve the problems. And we also agree that we also agree with the four objectives in our submission. First, there should be the public's awareness should be raised on the understanding and respect of children's rights, and there should also be enhancement of the healthy development of children. There should be healthy nutrition for children, and we should also ensure fairness. If we have the policy, we can have early identification intervention of youth problems. We can also help address the issue of aging and also reduce healthcare costs. In the long term, children's healthcare policy is the best solution. And if we can set up a children's commission, we can monitor the implementation of children's policy. And in terms of policy formulation, children and young people do not have a voice. We appeal to the government that in the process of formulation of policy, we should factor in the perspective of children and young people. The commission can speak on behalf of them and strive for the rights of children and young people. Children are the most important assets of society. We should make early investments to bring the maximum benefit for our society. We urge the government to formulate a forward-looking children's health policy. And let's not forget that children account for 20% of our population, but they will be 100% of our future. So we must leave no one out. Thank you, Ms. Chow Manasi. Ms. Fong Siu Lai, would you like to speak? No, I think she's covered everything. Thank you. Thank you, all the deputations for coming, the children. And also, from children's perspective, the children's expectation on the government. Now, some deputations talked about refugee children, which involves the Education Bureau, and also some basic needs of children. For the EM groups, they talked about teaching Chinese with Putonghua, and for NCS with special educational needs, the difficulties are very great, and the foundation has conducted an initial initial study. There is a unanimous view that the TSA should be scrapped, and there is also a suggestion that more support should be given to the children of foreign domestic workers because of their unique status or identity. It seems to be a loophole in our policy. And one deputation talked about the children in mainland Hong Kong families, and using Putonghua to teach Chinese is also one of the more absurd issues surrounding the EMs, and also for BMX, again the issue is raised. The Home Affairs Bureau would respond to that in a minute. Finally, on children's health policy, the proposal was submitted to the government in 2015, so perhaps the Food and Health Bureau should respond to that as well. So over to the government. Would Mr. Chang or Mr. Lai like to give a start? Mr. Lai from Education Bureau. I thank the deputations for all the comments. If I repeat the work that we have been doing, I will be criticized again for repeating my answer. But I just want to say that we do attach importance to schools, and we think that every school children should be given the right to receive education, and we therefore promote equal opportunities in school, in particular for non-Chinese speaking students and for NCS students with special educational needs. We understand the issues. We'd like to do more to help them. In short, we'd like to help them integrate into schools. And we've heard views from students, and just now there was an issue on legislation, and we do have the Disability Discrimination Ordinance enforced in schools to protect these students. So what we do is to promote integration in schools in terms of school policy, etc., so as to help the students. About this report on the preventing student suicide, the Education Bureau is working with other policy bureaus to follow up on the issue. For example, collaboration among the healthcare, education and welfare sector means that we can provide better support for students with mental problems. And this year, we've also enhanced the learning support subsidy for schools to take care of students with mental problems. For the gatekeeper training, we're going to train teachers on supporting and identifying students with suicidal tendencies. There'll be a booklet. At the school level, more will be done to promote mental well-being and mutual help and the prevention of stigmatization. And that's my brief response. Mr. Chang from Labour and Welfare Bureau. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to respond to Ms. Chen Kapui's comment on child care service, because this issue hasn't been much discussed at the two sessions. Well, it is said that the child care service is not sufficient at the moment, and we do acknowledge the shortage, and we have been striving to increase the number of child care centers and the number of places available. It is a challenge because of the locations available, and we're actively exploring the available sites at newly built public housing estates or large projects. The Social Welfare Department is trying to plan for more childcare centers for children between the age of 0 and 3, especially in districts with keener demand. And these are, apart from the childcare centers, we also have community nannies or temporary childcare services to meet the short-term needs. In the long term, last December, we commissioned the Hong Kong University to conduct a long-term study on the development of a child care service. This is a rather large-scale study which studies the positioning of child care service in Hong Kong, the demand and supply, and the mode of subsidy. There will be a comprehensive review, and recommendations will be made in the report. We believe the consultancy study is important, so we have try to invite more stakeholders to participate in it. On the 4th of April, our consultant will conduct a large-scale, conduct a major briefing session to consult the views of the stakeholders.
Lisa.
Hi.
Lee from Food and Health Bureau. Just now, Madam Chen Kapui referred to breastfeeding. Actually, the government has been actively promoting breastfeeding. Well, I have a colleague who has to do breastfeeding every day, so I fully know the needs for hygienic and private space for breastfeeding mothers. So that's why the Bureau, the Department of Health has already issued a guidelines some years back on breastfeeding facilities, and public facilities could include such space. Perhaps in the Southern District, this cannot be done yet due to technical obstacles, but because of the guideline, different government departments are working very hard on this. And then in hospitals, now once after giving birth, It's important how nurses teach new mothers to do breastfeeding. There's a UN Children's Education Fund, and there's some action plan for caring for infants. So for all 8 public hospitals with the obstetrician and obstetric and gynecology departments, they have need certification, and then they will be called a hospital that cares for young for infants, and that means in these hospitals they would teach mothers how to do breastfeeding. And then there's a child health policy mentioned. The government attaches great importance to providing healthcare services to children. We have various clinics and facilities. We have the school health program, dental health program, and then the hospital authority have pediatric wards and so on, and clinics also. And then there will be more hospitals coming on stream. Hopefully then there will be a children's hospital to be commissioned in phases. Hopefully we could then provide better services to children. And we will also review where there are inadequacies in the facilities we provide for children, and we welcome views on that. Thank you. So you have facilities, but you don't have a policy. Okay. We should end at 7, but the government officials haven't finished responding, and I also need to leave some time for members. So if you, there's no objection, I will extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Is it fine with the other with the deputations? Yes, Ms. Ma from Home Affairs Bureau. Yes, on Monday, 4 individuals spoke or raised their concerns about BMX, and I went back to find out more from subject officers. Now, on the Hong Kong Jockey Club International BMX Park at the Gin Drinkers Bay in Kwai Chung, where the government has been in liaison with the Hong Kong Cycling Association. Now, since the park was commissioned, it's run on a self-financing basis, and the government would monitor the use of the site on the basis of the relevant tenancy or land lease. And we understand the Cycling Association has no plans to abandon the BMX park. The park is closed only temporarily. And yes, on the repair works of the BMX park, the Cycling Association invited tender, but the tender prices were higher than expected. So the Cycling Association is trying to work out the next step, but the government has been in communication with them, and we have given concrete views on the enhancement proposals. And for example, we suggested that given the current license, the Cycling Association could receive commercial sponsorships to maintain and repair the BMX park. So we hope that they will have more sources of revenue. Thank you. Mr. Chen, Ms. Chen from Environmental Protection Department and from LCSD, well, you don't have views. In that case, I will open the floor to members. Now, of course, every time after a government official spoke, I would have a million things to say to refute to them, but I can't do that because we're running out of time. So over to you, members, Mr. Leung. Same point, Mr. Chairman. The government has given answers, but they haven't given any answers. But we can't just let them off like this. So I have a request. Can I now, the government departments have listened to all the views expressed in the 2 public hearings. So please don't just recite what you've been doing or what you've done in the past. Tell us what you're going to do in the future so you could address all the issues raised. Can you give us a roadmap and a timetable? Can you give us clear answers? Then we could pass on the information to the deputation, because they have spent the whole afternoon here to give their views and then they leave empty-handed. No, that's not good. So can the government departments give us a detailed response? Yes, we'll ask for a written response, and then we can see what you plan to do. That's the first point. Second point, the Kwai Chung BMX Park. I think what the Home Affairs Bureau said now amounted to nothing. I find that odd. in the policy address, the government said they take very seriously sports development. But if they cannot resolve the BMX park problem, then the government must step in. You can't just say you're keeping liaison and learn about progress, because there's no progress. So what are you doing as the government? I hope the Home Affairs Bureau colleagues would do something. Don't just beat around the bush. It means nothing. You're wasting the youth of the children. They don't have much longer to waste. You can't just keep saying that we are in communication with them, we are suggesting them to do this and the other, but you should have done it long ago. If you're only suggesting them to do something now, you've been negligent in doing your work. And if you have not asked them to make improvement in the past, that means you're not doing proper monitoring. So again, that's negligence of duty. Anyway, a third point. Now, I've been at both hearings, not everybody said this, but some have pointed out that international schools are much more popular than local schools. For SEN students or mainstream students, they all think international schools are much nicer. Why? Why are international schools more popular? What are the implications on the education system, and why is that the case? How can we make local schools as popular as international schools then? One other point. For the child refugees, we need to take care of them, but how can we do it? I think you have to give a response in one go at the end, Mr. Yip Kin Yun. Mr. Leung Yu Chong mentioned international schools. Yes, we're all very much concerned about it. For local schools, why is it there are so many problems? The Education Bureau should be held responsible. Education Bureau now practices school-based management. That means one school could do something and it's entirely up to the school. In terms of quality control, the Education Bureau would only do assessments. Other than that, the Education Bureau does not play an active role. Before there was school-based management, especially in the past when we had the Education Department, the Education Department was directly responsible for how schools perform. So this is a very different approach. But which is a better approach? I think we need to review it. Shall we keep this current approach? Just now, someone said kindergartens wouldn't accept EM students. So shouldn't the Education Bureau have a role to play there, or are they going to leave it to kindergartens again? And then what about excessive homework in schools? Is there a role to play for the Education Bureau under the school-based management approach? But perhaps you couldn't answer all the questions now, but I think it's something you really must look into. And perhaps I should allow the deputations here to say something. Well, there's a new government soon. Is there something you think is really important? I'll give you 10 or 15 seconds. Something that's really important that you want the government to help you with. Who would like to say something there, please? Yes. 3 hands, 4 hands, 5, 6, 7. 7 hands were up. I don't have much time left, I'm sorry. Okay, first one. Ms. Cheung Tin Wing. Well, to follow up on what I said, I hope the Labour and Welfare Bureau would deal with the case of foreign domestic helpers who have babies, about their maternity leave and the living rule. Could there be any adjustments there? Can you do a study there? Mr. Christian Hawani?
Following on from the comments about kindergartens being essential for Chinese language learning, there needs to be more support to help children learn Chinese in kindergartens and supporting parents as well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Feng Guanghuan.
Thank you. Ms. Hong Kong, no TSA, no BCA. We have to save the lives of students, and we must start from education reform. Ms. Kawa? Apart from the 2 points made, 1 point is very important. Chinese as second language. Eddie Ng said it's easy to formulate curriculum to develop textbook, so just put it into action. Eddie Zhang, do away with BCA this year and review the entire education system. Tong Chung-Yi, abolish TSA this year and trim the curriculum and pay attention to the BMX athletes. Either it's the LCSD or the Home Affairs Department. Don't drag things on anymore. The athletes have been waiting for a long, 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 long time. I hope the government would do what you should do. You say there should be commercial sponsorship, but that it's just only the size of 4 containers. So what sponsorship are you talking about? We've actually sought a donation, but the Cycling Association is not a registered charitable organization. It can't issue receipts, and who would make donations? Okay, we'll leave it. We'll ask the government to respond one go later on. Dr. Kwakaki, Mr. Chairman, thank you. I'd like to thank all the deputations for coming here on a Saturday afternoon to say something very important. It's not fair they have spent a lot of time, but the officials are just giving standard answers. So we must ask the officials to answer all the questions raised today. But we don't have much time. First, BNX, when can the park be used? Do you have a time frame? Ms. Ma? Today, tomorrow, next week, when? I need to go back and ask the subject office, sorry. But they've been asking about it for several years and you can't give us a time frame. Last week we asked about it. How long? 1 month, 2 months? Otherwise that's pointless. How long? How long? Tell us. How long? Sorry, really. I can't speak on behalf of my colleagues, but on Monday, after the meeting, I immediately asked for information, and after this meeting, I'll do it again. Sorry, Ms. Ma. Yes, I know in your position you can't answer the question, but it shows that the Bureau does not show any respect to this Council, and you don't show respect to people who've come here to give their views, because you represent your Bureau here, and every time you just read from script, and when members have questions, you just serve as a messenger. No. This is not the role you should play as being sent here by the Home Affairs Bureau. You shouldn't just be a messenger. As I think the subcommittee should write to Lau Kong Wah and express our dissatisfaction with the arrangement today. Okay, second question. I'm asking this on behalf of parents. Mr. Cheng, many parents have said that you should abolish TSA this year. Can you say whether you do it? Mr. Lai? I think at the last meeting, we already said that the TSA serves a certain function. And we can see that in the process, schools support this arrangement. See, that's official line, and they're pitching themselves against the people. So I have nothing more to say, because that's how they answer questions. So anyway, next point. The Children's Fund, the Pediatric Foundation said we should pay attention to two issues, the queuing time and further consultations, and how long is the wait now for child psychological services? Sorry, I don't have the information at hand, but I know that in the coming financial year in the budget, we are giving $2 billion to the hospital authority, and out of that, $73 million are for strengthening mental health services. And we know there will be additional outpatient clinic places, but I don't have the figures at hand. I'll give the figures after the meeting. Well, I find it disappointing. Mr. Lee is here on behalf of the Bureau to talk about child healthcare service, including child mental health service, but you don't even have basic information. But anyway, I can tell you, for the less urgent cases, the wait is more than 5 years. It's a shame, Mr. Chairman. the government is sitting on billions of dollars of reserve. This year there's a surplus of over $90 billion. Anyway, I'm not going to waste further time, but all our questions must be answered in writing. Yes, yes, your question about waiting time, they must give a written reply. We understand the waiting is more than 1 year. We talk about 3-4 years. Okay, because of time constraint, I really have to extend the meeting a bit longer so we could finish within 10 minutes, I think. No, any objection? No? Then Deputy Chairman, Mr. Xu, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm going to make just one remark very briefly. It may sound trivial, but for the persons concerned, I think that this is a major issue. I'd like to remind Mr. Lai Kam Tong, just now when you talked about student suicide, you talked about collaboration among the healthcare sector, the education and welfare sector, and that's all right. But I think that you are suggesting that student suicide has to do with mental illness, and on more than one occasion, you relate student suicide to mental illness. It seems that these two are interchangeable. I think for friends in the Alliance on the Prevention of Student Suicide, they feel resentful because we don't want to equate these two things. I understand that you are concerned about students' mental well-being and psychological health, but student suicide doesn't mean mental illness. All right, I think I need to give my concluding remarks now. Today, the government representatives have not responded to many of the issues. For example, pathfinders just now raised an issue about children of foreign domestic workers, from the mother's pregnancies to the delivery of babies. I think the Labour and Welfare Bureau should formulate a policy on this matter. But now, government policies have neglected this issue. For refugees, it falls partly within the remit of Labour and Welfare Bureau and the Education Bureau, and again, this is a blind spot. For non-Chinese-speaking ethnic minorities, especially for SEN students, they face huge difficulties. I think the Bureau should take note of that. The EM deputations have also criticized using Putonghua as a medium of instruction for Chinese language. It affects their effective learning of Chinese. And in the last session, the Education Bureau hasn't answered this question. For Muslim students or students with other religious backgrounds, they may need to meet certain attire requirements because of their religion, which may not entirely tally with the school uniform requirements. The Education Bureau, however, has ignored the issue. I think that it touches, it amounts to discrimination against the student's race or religion. So if this issue is not addressed, I think it's unacceptable. And many deputations talked about taking pressure off students. We should do away with unnecessary exams and TSA should be scrapped. And the Education Bureau has remained stubborn. I think that we must wait for the result of the C election tomorrow and see if the election pledge will be honored. And we'll continue to fight for that if they do not honor the promise. And there are also other issues on children's health policy and other issues like Ms. Silai-san mentioned, children of new arrival families and also BMX park and also parks and swimming courses of the LCSD. There aren't sufficient places and we're not doing justice to our children. We have had 3 sessions of public hearing. We have heard a lot of views and I'm appealing to all government departments here. All the comments received today and on Monday should be considered, and there should be a response from the administration. At least with these sessions of public hearing, we have created a platform for the EM groups and concerned groups to express their views and the children's expectation on the government. The new administration will be formed very soon. I hope that the new administration can take note of our views. At the next meeting, we will discuss the setting up of the Children's Commission. I hope that, well, if you have views on this issue, please attend the next meeting. The next meeting will be held on Thursday, 20th of April, 2017 at 10:45 a.m. And today's meeting is adjourned. Thank you.